Hello and welcome to Health Live at Seniors Today. We are delighted to have here with us Dr. Karobi Lahiri. Dr. Lahiri has over 3 decades of experience as a leading eye specialist. She is a consultant at the Bombay Hospital Institute of Medical Sciences in Mumbai. She's an associate professor of ophthalmology, a consultant VR surgeon, and a pediatric ophthalmologist, all at the Bombay Hospital. She is an award-winning doctor. She has done her MS in ophthalmology and a variety of other specializations, including from the Shankar Netralaya. She's written 5 books, book chapters, and 10 publications. And she was a recipient of the Best Fellow Award from the Shankar Netralaya. She was among the top doctors in Mumbai in 2012 and 2018. She was also a former president of the Bombay Ophthalmologists Association. And we're delighted to have you with us, Dr. Lahiri. And I know those of you who are here and have been waiting, Dr. Lahiri has just come in from 3 procedures at the Bombay Hospital. As I mentioned, she's a pediatric ophthalmologist, and ophthalmology itself, surgeries are delicate, and when it's children, it's all the more so. Thank you once again, Dr. Lahiri, and it's over to you. So the topic of the discussion is going to be on diabetic retinopathy and eye care for diabetic senior citizens. So it's over to you, Dr. Lahiri.
Thank you so much, Mr. Maheshwari. At the outset, let me thank Mr. Maheshwari and my friend Neelam Sethi and Vikram Sethi for this opportunity to address all the senior citizens present in this group. I thought that focusing on diabetes and its effects on the eye and diabetic retinopathy would be a worthwhile topic, because the number of people who are affected by diabetes and its complications that affect the eye are really too many, and it's on the rise. So I think it's a good topic to share today. I will share certain information with you. I will show you certain things where you would be familiar with how things happen in the eye, and even a little bit of surgery I will show you, so that you know what is the pitfall if you don't keep your diabetes and blood pressure and cholesterol, etc., under control. And I think I'll just now start sharing my screen, and I'll go over to the topic. Later, after we finish, I welcome you to ask whatever questions you have in mind. Can you see the screen?
Yes, we can see it. We can see it.
Okay. So today's topic is the diabetes and its effects on the eye, and we are focusing more on diabetic retinopathy, which is affecting the retina and the back part of the eye. Now, in short, if we show this is the external anatomy of the eye. And the external anatomy of the eye, as you all see, that only 1/3 part of it is what is seen in front. But if you see, this is the whole area behind, which is like 2/3 lies behind the lids. So the thing is that, and you have the retina over here, the choroid in between, and the sclera, which is a continuation of the white part of the eye that you see. The black part which you see in the external part is the pupil, and surrounding that is the iris, and just behind lies the lens. If you see the lens on the right hand side photograph, you see that it's suspended by ligaments, which we call suspensory ligaments, and the back part houses the vitreous cavity, which has got the vitreous humor, and the retina lies in close opposition to it. So if you look at the photographs down, you have the optic nerve, which you see over here, and the blood vessels which arise out of it. And the small dark portion which you see is the macula, which is the most important part of the eye. So any effect to the macula can cause a whole lot of difference to the vision of the patient. Now, diabetes worldwide is now estimated to be about 422 million. And there is a projected rise of about 629 million estimated by the year 2045. So you see that these numbers are just going up, they're not coming down. Partly it is according to our lifestyles and how we lead it, but a lifestyle change is what is required if you want to get these things under control. Now, diabetes, it damages the blood vessels all over the body. So you have effects of diabetes all over the body. It damages the eyes also, where the sugar blocks the tiny blood vessels in your retina and causes them to leak fluid and bleed. And to make up for these blocked vessels, your eye, as a response, starts growing new blood vessels. But these new blood vessels do not have the integrity of the old blood vessels, the normal blood vessels. And on least provocation, these break down and bleed. So this is diabetic retinopathy, as we call it, that this is a disease of the retina where diabetes affects us, is most common cause of blindness between 20 to 70 years of age. Now, knowing a little about the types of diabetes, there are three types, main types, which is a type 1, which is the juvenile diabetes. This is the most ferocious kind of diabetes, and it occurs between 10 to 20 years, where the person is not able to produce insulin, and that's the reason why it occurs, because the sugar cannot be controlled then, because we require insulin, which is generated in the pancreas to keep the sugars under level. The type 2 diabetes differs from type 1, where insulin is produced, but the body and the cells are incapable of processing that insulin, and that's why the sugar rises. And this is common amongst people between 50 to 70 years of age, and this is the more common type of diabetes. And the gestational diabetes, as the name suggests, is associated with pregnancy, because if the person is a candidate for it, or just because of the sugar levels going high, the during pregnancy, the diabetes creeps in, but it settles also after the pregnancy is over. Now, approximately, although the retinopathy usually does not appear for the first 5 years after type 1 diagnosis, it may be present when type 2 is diagnosed. And after 15 years, we have a probability of 98% of type 1 developing diabetes and diabetes eye disease, and 78% of those with type 2 have some degree of retinal damage. So you see that what is important over here is the diabetic age. What do we mean by diabetic age? Diabetic age is the number of years that you have had diabetes, whether it's 5 years, 10 years, 15 years. And as this age advances, it becomes possible to develop these changes. So a strict glycemic control is very important for all patients who are suspected or proved to be diabetic. Now, the prevalence of diabetes is in type 2, it's about in 90% of diabetic patients. So a lesser percentage have juvenile diabetes. The risk of developing diabetic retinopathy in these types of diabetes in type 1 is about 70%. In type 2, it is 39%. And type 2 on insulin is 70%. So what are the symptoms? There are 7 signs which tell you that probably you may have a diabetic eye disease. That is, your night vision, suppose, has changed. You can't see better in the night. If you have some discharge or constant infections of the eye, frequent headaches, vision disruptions, chronic eye fatigue, light sensitivity, and difficulty in focusing. These things kind of tell you that, okay, you need an eye check to go and see if there is any kind of problem in the eye. Now, diabetes, the symptoms, apart from blurred vision, seeing colors, floaters, you can get patches or streaks if there is blood in the eye. As I said, poor night vision is one of them. Sometimes, if the macula is affected, you can get an empty spot in the center or a black spot in the center, which is called as a scotoma. And if there is a bleed in the eye, you can get a sudden and a total loss of vision also. So with advanced type of diabetes, this is the kind of picture that you may see if there are effects in the center and in the pericentral areas of the retina. Now, so you have to schedule a diabetic eye examination as soon as you notice eye problems. And if you've been diagnosed with diabetes or you're a pre-diabetic, then definitely go in for an eye examination. So what do we do? We generally, when a patient comes to us, we check the vision of the patient. We see the patient's the front part of the eye, the back part of the eye. We dilate the eye with certain drops. And at the back part, we look for abnormalities in the blood vessels, in the optic nerve or retina. Presence or absence of cataracts is also quite likely. Eye pressure is measured because glaucoma is also a common variant. New blood vessels growing on the optic nerve or elsewhere in the retina is also diagnostic. And sometimes there are traction detachments of the retina. And if this has got fibrous, you can get scar tissues in the retina. So what are the effects of diabetes in the eye? The effects are cataracts. You can get glaucoma, which is a raised intraocular pressure of the eye. Retinopathy concerns the retina, which could be of the non-proliferative type and the proliferative type. Macula is the area which I showed you some time back, and you can get a swelling in that part called as macular edema. You can get a bleed in the vitreous cavity, which is called vitreous hemorrhage. You can get a traction retinal detachment in the retina, and sometimes the optic nerve can get inflamed, which is called as optic neuritis. Now, the diabetics are 2 or 4 times more likely to develop cataracts than non-diabetics. They develop it faster, especially if the sugars go above 200 milligrams per cent and are not brought back quickly, and they maintain these high sugars for a long time. It also is seen that people who have brittle diabetes, where the diabetes tends to fluctuate, that is, you get high sugar and low sugar alternating, these also develop great changes of diabetic retinopathy in the eye, because theirs is a labile status. And the risk always increases if a person has poor diabetic control and high HbA1c or a kidney disease. So diabetic cataract, you know, the visual outcome, suppose you have a cataract and you get a cataract surgery done for in a diabetic, the prognosis of the vision recovery in these patients would depend on the severity of the retinopathy before surgery. So a look into the back part is mandatory. When we see a cataract, we have to see the back. But suppose, say, there are advanced cataracts and you cannot see it, then you have to remove the cataract and immediately a few days later assess the condition of the back part. And if there are signs of retinopathy, you have to treat it within the first 2 weeks. Or it is generally seen that there is an escalation of the diabetic processes in the eye almost 3 times of what it is in case you do not treat the retinopathy or the maculopathy before your cataract surgery. So you either do it before or you do it immediately after. So that's very important. So control sugars, control your retinopathy and maculopathy before the cataract surgery, unless it is a dense cataract and it doesn't allow visibility. So there is something called as a proliferative retinopathy. As the name suggests, you get proliferations of new blood vessels either on the retina or on rest of the retina or on the optic nerve. So here what we do is a laser treatment prior to surgery. Sometimes we resort to injections also to numb these vessels or to shrink them. Now, diabetic maculopathy involves the center, and generally you get a lot of hard exudates in the eye, and there it is mostly related to hyperlipidemia. So the cholesterol assessments are important, and you have to get the cholesterol this under control. Now, many a times what we do is that if there is an elevated lipids, then what we do is that we control the lipids first with medications, and maybe 3 or 4 weeks down the line, we may start the treatment, because many a times controlling the lipids helps to ameliorate the findings below, and we get a reduction in whatever structures are there, whatever problem is there behind. If the cataract is not dense, you treat the maculopathy with laser or injections before and do a cataract extraction later after resolution. And as I said, if it is dense, you remove it and then follow it up with treatment. So if a person has advanced retinopathy, then it reduces the vision after cataract by 50%. If there is severe preoperative disease, the visual prognosis for this patient is poor. It's not like any cataract which you go and remove and expect good visual function. If there is a prevalent problem behind, it definitely decreases the amount that you can see after a cataract extraction. And if there is an uncomplicated cataract extraction, it does not worsen any kind of diabetic manifestations that may be there in the eye. So what is important is there are certain risk factors which you have to keep in mind, which may aggravate the diabetes or the diabetic processes in the eye, like the amount of time the diabetes has been there, if there has been poor control of the diabetes, if there is associated hypertension, kidney problems or nephropathy, obesity or hyperlipidemia, that is the cholesterol are high. If a person is a smoker or pregnancy, many a times aggravates the diabetic retinopathy in the eye. So these are the risk factors. So you have to keep proper emphasis on these people who are diabetics, especially pregnant women. You have to be very careful. So this is the photographs. Now let's go to some photographs. This is the photograph of a normal looking retina. That's the optic nerve. Those are the blood vessels, the macula. Everything looks very healthy, the right and the left eye. Now, if you see in a diabetic retinopathy, on the right hand side, you have a normal variant, and this is how the figure on the right side shows you what is the kind of changes that you get in a diabetic retinopathy. There are a lot of these shiny yellow particles or hard exudates which are converging onto the macula. There are some laser marks which you see over here, and there is bleed from one of the new vessels where there is a collection in the lower part of the eye. So this is how it happens. It's a complication of diabetes, affects small blood vessels of the eye, and the blood vessels begin to leak and bleed inside the eye. Now there are four stages of diabetic retinopathy that we divided grossly as non-proliferative and proliferative. What we mean by proliferative, growth of new vessels in the eye, either on the optic nerve or elsewhere, and the non-proliferative can be segregated into mild, moderate and severe. So just to go over a few things, that there are some things which are called as microaneurysms. I'm not getting the cursor over here, but what you see where aneurysms are written, those are the areas where these are small red dots which are there. These are the clinically first to be detected. Hemorrhages, that is small blood clots all over the retina, and the yellowish dots that you see, these are the hard, these are the soft exudates. The shiny ones are the hard exudates. These are the signs of a mild NPDR or a non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy. When it goes into a moderate stage, all those three are there, plus the venous beading, which you see in the figure on your right, where you can see that the vessel is beaded. So you know the chai patient has gone, and there are areas in the figure down, you see that there is a certain area where there are no blood vessels. So that is an area of capillary non-perfusion. So these are moderate NPDR. And then we go into, this is again a moderate NPDR. And then we go into a severe NPDR, where there are microaneurysms in all four quadrants, you get venous beading in more than two quadrants, and you get IRMAs, that is intraretinal microaneurysms, in one quadrant at least. So this is then known as the 4-2-1 rule. And this is how these conditions look like. You know, I mean, there are soft exudates, there are IRMAs, there is hard exudates, there are small dot and blot hemorrhages. These are how it looks. And this is something which has gone into a very, very severe state, which is very severe NPDR, which has any two features of the 4-2-1 rule. This is again this way you are seeing a venous beading, and there's cotton wool spots and venous segmentation, that's segmentation of the blood column. And on the right hand side, you can see the scars of the laser spots along with absorbing hemorrhages. So we've spoken about the non-proliferative. The proliferative is where the new vessels start to grow onto the retina, and because it grows, it can grow on the surface of the retina, or it can encroach into the substance of the vitreous, and that is when it leads to scarring and wrinkling, because fibrovascular proliferations grow into the vitreous. These acquire some kind of fibrotic tissues, they shrink and they scar, and they can cause bleeds if there is a pull on any new vessels of the eye. And this is again another few pictures to show you the proliferative processes. There is new vessels on the optic nerve, and there are new vessels elsewhere in the retina. The one up is the elsewhere thing, and the one down is on the surface of the optic nerve. So this is another to show you new vessels on the disc and new vessels elsewhere. This is another page of the same proliferative processes. Few more pictures. And then suppose there is a pull then it can result into vitreous bleeds, as you see in the lower in these two pictures. So then we have something called as a diabetic macular edema, where you see the hard exudates which are coming onto the center. There is a swelling in the center, and it presents with dimness of vision and loss of and decrease in vision. Now this can be associated with an NPDR and PDR, so you can get a combination of all these things, you know. So this is another piece of NPDR with a CSME, that is a cystoid macular edema. This is a succinate ring at the center of which are microaneurysms. These cause leakages to gravitating to the center, because that is the watershed zone of the eye. It's deep, so all the blood collects. Now suppose this is unbidden or untreated, it tends to progress, and if you see on this photograph, there is blood vessels which are growing on the iris next to the pupillary area, and this is called as rubeosis iridis. As the name suggests, there is blood vessels on the surface of the iris, and it can lead to bleeds or vitreous hemorrhage, which you see here, and it can lead to scarring and traction retinal detachments in the photograph down. This is again how bleeds occur. This is a subhyaloid bleed, and suppose this breaks down into the entire vitreous cavity, you get a total loss of vision where you are not able to even see anything. So there we generally have to do an ultrasound and see whether the eye is okay, that is the retina is in place, or if there's traction or there's any pull. So complication of a rubeotic iritis, these new vessels, if they are not treated, they start growing into what is called as the angle. The angle is at the far corner of the iris, and that is where the filtration occurs. So if the blood vessels block the filtration sites, you get a mechanical obstruction to the outflow, and that's how your pressure rises, or you get what is called as glaucoma. The pupil can get rigid, distorted. The eye can become painful red, because it's like a football which has been infused with a lot of air. You know, so the aqueous is what makes it tighter, the outflow channels are blocked, and that is what we call as glaucoma. And if it's not checked, it can lead to loss of vision also. The new vessels around the pupillary edge, you see the rubeotic vessels, and these are the figure on the right shows new vessels growing in the angle of the eye. So screening is generally done once in a year if there is mild NPDR, but once in 6 months if there is moderate NPDR. But if the patient has a severe, you have to treat immediately, and then the scheduled appointments as per your treatment demands. So this is how a normal person sees, and this is how a person with a diabetic retinopathy would be seeing. So it's a very marred kind of visibility. Again, vitreous subhyaloid hemorrhage and vitreous hemorrhage. And if you see, these are how the traction detachments occur on the retina, where fibrotic membranes start pulling on the retina, causing bleeds. Now, there are certain investigations which are necessary, as I just mentioned, ultrasound, but we generally do a color photo for documentation. The photograph in the middle is showing a fundus fluorescein angiogram, where we inject a dye in the vein of the hand, and we see what is leaking inside the eye, where there is area, where there is non-perfusion. It gives us a whole host of information. It helps us to prognosticate what would be the likely visual recovery, and also what treatment we have to best offer to the patient. And this is what is called as an OCT, which is down. On the left is the normal OCT down, whereas in the right side, if you see, there's a little gap, that is the macular edema or the swelling in the center, and corresponding color photos are seen on top. So as I said, fluorescein angiogram, optical coherence tomography, or the OCT as we mentioned, this is the fluorescein angiogram, the color photos, and this is the OCT along with the color photo and the fluorescein angiogram. This is the whole gamut which is required to monitor, to decide on treatment, and to monitor how well your treatment is helping the patients by doing serial OCTs even later. And this is different manifestations or types of patterns that you get on the OCT. Now, you get functional impairments, in difficulty in seeing fine details, fluctuations in vision from hour to hour or day to day, blurred vision, hazy or double vision, sometimes difficulty in night, as I've already told you, sensitivity to glare and light, and focusing difficulties. So these all things you have to be very careful of. Now, there is a certain medical kind of macular edema that we have to be aware of. That is, there is a drug which is called as a glitazones, that is pioglitazone, which is given to a lot of diabetics. We have to be very careful to monitor this via OCT, because glitazones are known to produce macular edema. So if you do not know this fact, what happens is that you tend to think that it is the diabetic process which is causing the macular edema, but no, it is the glitazone which is causing it. So if you see, this is the patient where the second one, 4 weeks after pioglitazone, then there is a worsening 6 weeks later where there's continued treatment, and then we withdraw the pioglitazone and see how it comes back to normal, and 3 months after this you can give Lasix also to reduce that, and you see that the anatomy comes back to normal. So the thing is that it's a chain of events, and this is something which you have to bear in mind. And the treatment runs as, you can give steroid treatment in the form of Ozodex small implants which are put inside the eye to combat the inflammation. You can give injections of anti-VEGFs in the eye. There are various kind of anti-VEGFs in the market, some cheap, some expensive, but they have to be given in a loading dose of 3 injections, and then as and when required. Then there is laser treatment, which you see, these are the laser marks, the yellowish dots which you see all over the retina, and then if the situation demands, you may have to do microsurgery. So these are all the forms of treatment that we have to offer. Here, this is a patient who would require a laser as well as an injection. This is a patient who would require a laser plus a surgery to remove all the fibrous tissue proliferations. This is a patient where you can just see the optic nerve. So right away he has to go in for surgery with an endolaser. And the thing is that the macula, if it is fired, the first 500 micron zone is the important zone, and anything around that is again classified into a maculopathy, that is CSME, that is, you get hard exudates right at the macula, you get hard exudates with a little swelling, or you get a area of one dysdiopter where there is a swelling in the remaining part of the retina. Now, as I was mentioning before, that you have to treat the maculopathy before you go in for a cataract, because if you don't do that, see this patient where you see in the last picture here a progression of the maculopathy 3 months after the cataract. It almost becomes triple what was there. And this is, if you have treated a patient, then there is stability post-cataract. And this is again a worsening case. And this is how a regressed this looks with a laser treatment. So that is all about the diabetic retinopathy. Now, coming to the glaucoma, there are issues where I told you the leading cause is the presence of blood vessels which grow into the angle, which is called as a neovascular glaucoma, or there is a specific glycoprotein which is elaborated, which is called as fibronectin. And having more fibronectin in your eye can block your eye's natural drainage system and lead to glaucoma. And remember that diabetic retinopathy usually affects people who've had diabetes for a long time, and what matters in these is that if the age is more, the diabetic age is more, or if there is an unmanaged blood sugar or a high blood pressure, which are the risk factors for worsening this condition. These are complications where you get severity, where you get rubiosis, where you get tractions, or you get hemorrhage. And this is just to show you how her hemorrhage is treated. This is a patient who is undergoing a vitrectomy for diabetic retinopathy. This is all the hemorrhage or the bleed which is within the eye, which is getting cut away with a sucker, with a cutter. And at the bottom of it, you see there is the retina appearing over there. And And there you see the optic nerve, which is getting cleared up. You clear up the following, and here you have a better view where you have to flush out whatever residual blood is there in the eye. And this is another patient where there is traction on the retina. These are patients, if you see an OCT like this, these are patients who are for surgery. And yet another patient where you see a vitreous hemorrhage and the vitrectomy in progress, where there are membranes which come on top of the retina, and then those membranes are very close to the retina, so you have to be very careful in dissecting it. And sometimes there are fronds which tend to bleed, so you have to excise those fronds and cauterize it. So you apply what is called as endocautery to all these kind of this, and at the end of it, if there is membranes which are covering the surface of this, that's the macula which you see below, you have to slowly peel off these membranes. So these are very delicate surgeries which require a lot of precision and concentration. And this is an endolaser treatment where after clearance we are putting the laser from inside. So what I would say, I would like to conclude this thing by saying that successful management of blood sugar will help you prevent diabetic retinopathy. Early detection of symptoms increases the effectivity of treatment. High blood pressure, hypertension is a contributing factor, cholesterol also. So eating healthy, balanced diet, avoid salt, exercise regularly, reaching and maintaining a certain moderate body weight. If you are a smoker, quit smoking, moderating your alcohol intake, and taking any antihypertensive measures as the doctor recommends. These are all the areas where you could sort of help yourself win over this disease. And if there is high blood pressure, high blood sugar, high cholesterol, pregnant, smoker, and had diabetes, you please take care. 98% of these with severe visual loss can be prevented by early detection and timely treatment. So have good control of all the three parameters which I already mentioned. And this is the same thing again. So control your diabetes and all will be well, even with diabetes. Thank you so much for your kind attention.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for this presentation. I think detailed and explanatory. We have a few questions that have come in.
Yes.
Shall I stop the screening of the?
Yeah, yeah. I want to stop the share. Yeah. No, let me stop the share.
All right. So, thank you once again for the very detailed presentation. We have somebody who's saying you have an amazing PPT. We have some questions that have come in. One from Colonel Duggal, who's not mentioned his age, but he's a regular here. He says, I'm diabetic. While looking at my iPad, my eyes hurt. What should I do?
He's a diabetic, all right, but constant use of white screens over 4 hours. I mean, it may be computer, it could be TV, it could be the laptop, it could be mobile. More than 4 hours of use, you tend to develop what is called as dryness of the eye, which is a different problem. And it's diabetic related, and it gets aggravated if the person also has diabetes. But constant use of white screens is supposed to give you eye strain, fatigue. This is what we call as a digital eye strain, and it manifests with greater amount of watering of the eyes. You can get mild discharges from the eye, sometimes mild redness, irritation, itching, foreign body sensations. These are all symptoms of dry eye. And what you have to have is that you have to have tear emollients, which you have to put on a regular basis. If you go to an ophthalmologist, he will do what is called as a Schirmer's test to detect what is the level of wetting that your eye has, and depending whether it's mild, moderate, severe, we utilize medications for preventing dryness. And this is also given in a certain quantum, in the sense either 4 times in a day or 6 times, or sometimes if it's very severe it may be 1 hourly also. So that is there. And along with that, you have to restrict your screen time. One, use what we call as a 20-20-20 rule, where every 20 minutes on a white screen you look out of the window 20 feet away for 20 seconds, because that reduces the amount of digital strain which is from computers. And also adjust the brightness of the computer to a reasonable level and see that the screen is at least 2 inches or 3 inches beneath the level of your eye. So these are few things that you can do to avoid this kind of glare and irritation or eye fatigue that you get from constant widescreen usage.
Doctor, so what is the, I was just, while you were answering this question, I was looking at my screen time usage on my phone and my daily average is 5 hours, 58 minutes.
Okay, so I think even if you, this, it's mandatory that you use a tear emollient or a lubricant because that will keep the eyes moist and it will help you. I mean, you will not get these irritation symptoms which crop up from time to time from continued widescreen usage.
Is there any specific brand or something that you would recommend?
As I told you, that the brands depend on the severity of the dryness. Like suppose, say there is a normal wetting of 15, somebody comes with a level of 13. So we give them something very mild, like we can give them Refresh Tears or we can give them Tears Natural Fort. There are a lot of formulations in the market. But the thing is that somebody who comes with a moderate or severe needs something which is even more sort of capable of maintaining the lubrication of the eye. So depending on the level, we decide on what we are planning to give the patient, you know. So that way in the market, you get a whole lot of formulations. There's Refresh Tears, there's Tears Natural, there is Gentle Drops, there is Moistane. A lot of drops are there, but we titrate it according to each patient, according to their need. And also the number of times that they have to put, because more dry, more number of times, less dry, two times is good enough. There are some people who clock more than 4 hours, but they don't have manifest dryness. But we tell them use the lubricants as a precaution. At least 2 or 3 times you should put it. Drink a lot of water because, you know, it helps your hydration, basically, of all the cells of the body.
Eyes have started burning even while speaking with you. But anyway, we have a question from Lakshmi Valecha.
Okay.
My husband's age is 72.
Okay.
He's diabetic. I have noticed change in the looks of his eyes. Now, she doesn't have a specific question, but I guess she wants some general advice.
Okay. See, if he's a diabetic, he should have... How many years diabetic is he?
She's not mentioned that, but she has mentioned that he is 72.
So maybe he's had it for the last 5, 10 years or 15 years, maybe. We don't know. Considering that... Anyways, it's better that he gets an eye checkup. If she finds externally an appearance which is different, it could be two things. One is elderly people tend to develop what is called as an arcus senilis, you know, which is around the cornea. So that gives a white ring around the cornea. So it tends to look a little more grayish than what a normal black looking eye would look like. That may be one cause, which is not diabetic related, that is age related. And the second thing is that if the patient is developing some kind of cataractous changes, if he's not had a cataract extraction before, that also could give a kind of a grayish appearance if the cataract is pretty advanced. So she needs to see, he needs to see an eye specialist to see what is the problem, either in the front or anything which is occurring at the back part of the eye in the retina.
Thank you. We have a question from Shantaram Ramdurkar. He is 75 years old and he is from Pune. He's a diabetic for the last 13 years. He wears spectacles, right eye cataract operation done, left eye operation due now. His question is, what special precautions should he take while driving a car, using mobile phone and other electronic gadgets?
No, he wants it like using a mobile while driving a car or just in general driving car?
He's
had a cataract extraction before, which may have been uneventful, and if his visibility is good and his sugars are under control and if he's at the 6-12 level where his vision is not improving with the glasses, he would require a cataract for the other eye also. Now the thing is that he needs to wear his glasses, which would be definitely for both the eyes if it is balanced, you know, I mean if the difference is not too much. And the thing is that to avoid glare, etc., because when you have a cataract you tend to have a lot of glare, you know, coming in, the light strikes the eye. So when you're driving and you have an advanced cataract in one eye, you develop these glare symptoms. So it is better that he puts that shade down in the car, or like, you know, he wears an anti-glare screen over the eye which still has a cataract, or in the other side also, because it would cut off your glare. And what else did he say during driving? And
during driving, using a mobile and other electronic gadgets.
Using a mobile or any widescreen, as I told you, that you have to be careful that you don't, if it is not necessary, you don't clock more than 4 hours. And if you have to clock more than 4 hours, you see that you're on lubricants, which keep your eye moist, and you drink lots of water, and all the other precautions which I told you, which you have to observe when you this. And rest, reading and all that, he can do everything without any problem. Now, in the widescreens, electronic gadgets, only the Kindle is something which is a backlit surface, so that is doesn't cause dryness. But all other white screens, you know, LED screens, these definitely cause dryness of the eye. And those blue rays also from that affect the eye to a certain extent, you know.
But we have two questions. One is from Sushil Kumar, who says, does use of blue cut lenses help in reduction in eye strain or damage?
The blue clear-cut lenses, which I just mentioned now 2 minutes back, these are an alternative for sort of cutting down the blue rays which come from the computer or any kind of white screen. And see, the blue rays definitely cause a lot of dryness and digital eye strain, etc. So if you have glasses which are blue cut, they help in reducing that. Now, but the thing is that I wouldn't propagate it as something which everyone needs to use, because if you are keeping your eye sufficiently moist, you are observing all the this of keeping the computer at a particular level, adjusting the brightness, doing the 20-20-20 rule, having a lot of water, and having an anti-glare. Maybe you have a screen guard on your computer, or you have an anti-glare on your glasses. These are also equally capable of helping you to cut off the blue rays. So it is not that every person needs to have, yes, somebody who can afford it, because they are expensive glasses. If you can afford it, go ahead for it, because it will cut down the blue rays. But suppose you are not that affording and you don't want to use that, these other things, which these techniques which I just mentioned, will also help you to attain the same kind of effects.
We have a question from Mr. Devendra Gada, who says, I am a diabetic since 14 years. I'm having headaches on the left side of the head every now and then.
Okay.
He's looking for some advice.
See, first of all, this you have to, if you're getting headaches, go in for an eye
examination.
It's
7 o'clock.
If it's not been done recently, and see if there is a refractive change, because many a times if the sugars are a little out of control, you get this water entering into the lens, and the swelling on the lens can cause frequent changes of refraction. So if you are getting frequent changes, if you have changed it and you're yet again finding a difficulty in focusing, or a frequent change, or you're not comfortable with your this, or there is blurry vision, means I feel somewhere your diabetes may not be under control. So get your whole glycemic package and all this package done, and go in for an eye examination to see what is happening. Also, it's important that if you're getting headaches along with it, you have to, somebody has to examine your optic nerve, because many a times optic neuritis or inflammations of the optic nerve can also give you these kind of things. So what is mandatory is that you have to go in for an eye check, and if your levels of sugar, cholesterol, etc. have not been done in the recent past, then please get it done.
Doctor, there's a question from an anonymous attendee who asks, what is the kind of light that one must have in the room? Because we can't really do away with our electronic devices. What is the light level you recommend? And is there any specific light that you recommend that one must have?
See, it's like this. When a person is reading, okay, we prefer the light coming from up or coming from behind. There should be no light shining into your eye. And where it is a question of electronic gadgets, now you have screens on that, like where you have a night mode and you have a day mode. Now, if you put it on a day mode, then you adjust your brightness going on to the settings to a level which is comfortable to your eye. Because if you keep it at a high level, it causes a glare phenomenon in the eye. So you can adjust it on your screen itself. And suppose it's the daytime, you can reduce the brightness of the screen because that will give you the comfort level that you require without, you know, sort of taxing your eye. And if it is in the night, you can go into the night mode, and there are more peaceful colors which come up on the night mode, which helps you see your computer screens that way. So an ambient light above, back, doesn't matter. But the thing is that you can always adjust it with the brightness of your screen. And ideally, what is mentioned is that 1 hour before you sleep, generally, preferably, electronic gadgets or white screens should not be used because it affects your sleep cycles. So the thing is that I know it's easier said than done because most of us keep working in the night, but that is the dictum. And if it follows, then your sleep pattern also improves because the serotonin secretion is sort of better.
Thank you, Doctor. We've asked you quite a few questions. There have been a couple of questions which have come in, which are not exactly on eye care, like from Mr. Radhakrishna, so I'll not take that. But thank you once again, Dr. Lahiri, for spending your time here with us today. Thank you for responding to all the questions. And as somebody said, this was an amazing PowerPoint presentation by you. Thank you very much once again.
No, I mean, I just wanted to make it a little more descriptive and with photographs, because then you know what happens inside, you know. So if you see it pictorially, you know that this is something which you have to avoid. So seeing it is also very important. And I wanted it to be practical as well as informative also, but at a level where it becomes easier to understand the jargon that we speak, you know. So I hope I've been able to convey that.
You know, the opportunity to get it from someone as experienced as you. There are presentations available. There's information available on the internet that's there. But, you know, getting it firsthand from somebody as experienced as you, somebody who's seen, you know, who's done a body of work, it's amazing. So thank you very much, Dr. Lahiri, for this. And thank you for coming in soon after your procedures. You know, I know what.
Sorry for the little delay that I caused you.
That's all right. That's absolutely okay. I think, you know, we were feeling a little guilty to pull you in from the surgery. So thank you once again. And thank you, everyone, for being here. We started out a little late this Saturday, but again, next week, we will be back at 5 p.m. So please join us again for the next round of Health Live at Senior Today. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much.